Hi everyone, my name is Guillaume and I design adaptive streaming algorithms at Netflix. And today I am going to talk about how we are using Bayesian optimization to improve streaming experience. Bayesian optimization, such a scary term. Don't worry, I was also scared at first, but let me try to explain through a simple use case why we use such technique and how it works. This project is a joint work with Denis Thor and our entire team. I would like to start by really thanking them all for their help. So now, imagine the following scenario. It is 6 p.m. and you are commuting back home. You grab your smartphone, open your favorite streaming app, select something to watch, then click play. The video starts pretty quickly. But a few seconds later, you end up having a rebuffer. A rebuffer? In 2021? How is this even possible? What would be a perfect experience instead? Well, it's pretty simple, right? We would just like the playback to start quickly with a high video quality and no rebuffers. And you can usually experience that on a fast and stable network. Unfortunately, it's not always possible as sometimes resources are constrained. There could be multiple reasons for that. You might be far away from the cell tower and losing signal. Networks could also be congested and the throughput could become limited or spiky, hence not easily predictable. Your cellular antenna might have turned into sleep mode to save battery and it takes time to reconnect. Another use case could be that background tasks using network resources could be just competing with streaming. To navigate all these constraints, we use adaptive bitrate streaming, also known as ABR. So for those not familiar with ABR, it is a method of streaming where the content is encoded at multiple bitrates ahead of time. The ABR algorithm then decides in real time which bitrate to download at a given time and when to start the playback, based on the state of the network and various device characteristics. ABR face two big challenges. First, when resources are constrained, we need to make trade-offs between our three objectives, which are play delay, video quality, and risk of rebuffers. To illustrate this, if you want to start quickly, you just download a small amount of content, but the risk of rebuffers increases. On the other side, if you want to avoid rebuffers, you will have to download a lot of content before starting the playback, but your play delay will be much higher. The same kind of trade-offs also apply between the other pairs of metrics. And the best configuration is subjective. Some might prefer that playback starts quickly with a low video quality, while others might prefer higher initial video quality, even if the playback takes a bit longer to start. As you can see there is not a single best configuration. Our job is then to find the set of best configurations or optimal operating points, which is also called the Pareto frontier. The Pareto frontier, in our use case, represents the surface that maximizes video quality while minimizing rebuffer risks and play delay. Intuitively, any point in the Pareto frontier is optimal. This is, I cannot improve one metric without degrading another. Points outside of this surface, however, have room for improvement. For example, we may increase play delay for the same rebuffer rate and video quality. And there is clearly no reason to deploy such a configuration. We cannot really say which point on this Pareto frontier is better. However, once we have this surface, we can potentially conduct user studies to figure out where we should operate on. But that's not our focus here. In this talk, we will focus on how to find this optimal surface. So, we've seen how hard it is to optimize for just a single session. But it is even harder when you consider the scale and diversity of sessions in the wild. Our second challenge is that we would like a single solution that works across a large and diverse set of conditions. So now we need to find a way to address these two challenges. How can we do that? We have plenty of operating points available. We will have to rely on exploration to understand QE effects for each of these operating points. There are a lot of aspects we don't control, and the environment we are dealing with is really diverse. A common approach to understand the QE effects on this diverse environment is to rely on a data-driven experimental approach using A-B tests. But the problem is that the search space is huge. This is really challenging for us using an experimental approach, and no way we could set up such large A-B tests. Just to give you an idea, testing 10 different values for 3 configuration parameters already gives 1,000 combinations. With 100 different values, we end up with 1 million combinations. So, we really need a methodology to systematically explore this space. Let's start with something we know well. We choose a set of configs that should provide reasonable trade-offs, and we start A-B testing them. We usually use a couple of test cells, not just two, to speed up the exploration. We then analyze the results and apply some magic from Bayesian optimization to find the next candidates. Then we repeat the process until we get a good modeling of the relationship between configuration values and QE. Now, let's go through a simple example, an EBR algorithm with one knob, one objective. And the objective here is to minimize rebuffer. So our first A-B test has 4 cells, each using a different configuration value as seen on the x-axis. The measured rebuffer rate can be read on the y-axis. What we would like to find is the coordinate on the x-axis that is the most likely to minimize rebuffer given these observations. We obviously can't A-B test all values. So, how can we ensure we found the configuration value that minimizes rebuffer? Any idea? The idea is to find a model capturing the relationship between the configuration values and the rebuffer metric. Here is my daughter Fleur. She's in first grade. I just asked her to try to find the relationship between the configuration value and our rebuffer rate, and where the rebuffer rate is expected to be minimum given the 4 points we have measured in our A-B tests. And this is the solution she came up with. One intuitive way to find relationships between configuration value and rebuffer rate is to connect the dots. Fleur drew around 6 curves, but there are so many possibilities. And here is where she thinks the rebuffer rate is more likely to be minimum. Extrapolating a bit, we can draw an infinite number of curves through these 4 dots, but some curve shapes are more likely than others. So, drawing curves and connecting dots is the main principle behind Bayesian optimization. Bayesian optimization is drawing a large number of curves connecting these 4 dots, then building a probability model of where our rebuffer rate should be for each configuration value. This is represented by the shaded area on the top graph. The darker, the more likely rebuffer rate will have this value. But Bayesian optimization is moving a step further. It maps these observations into probability of optimization. This probability is shown in the bottom graph. The higher the probability, the more likely we will minimize rebuffers. And intuitively it makes sense. It is really likely that rebuffers will be minimized not too far from our third point, as predicted by both my daughter and the model. Hence, if we need to pick candidates for the next round, we would pick configs which maximize this probability. So the great thing with this technique is that we are just exploring around our optimization goal. We don't need a complete modeling of the rebuffer rate. This really avoids testing suboptimal configurations and greatly reduces the search time. Bayesian optimization technique scales really well with multidimensional and with multiple knobs. In this graph, for example, we are now using two knobs to model our rebuffer rate. Bayesian optimization will model us a surface. Now, let's take a practical example and apply our methodology. We could design a simple algorithm with multiple knobs, let's say three, each knob aiming to control one trade-off. The first step is to define the knob's config for our first A-B test. As you can see, all the knobs have been tuned differently here. Let's get this test running, and here are the results of this first A-B test. Each row represents one of the main metrics, namely initial quality, play delay, and rebuffers. For each row, the dotted line is the metric value in the control cell. Are any of these optimal trade-offs? We don't know yet. We first need to apply modeling. So, from this first A-B, we start modeling our metrics. See below, this is a modeling of initial quality after the first A-B. Remember that our objective is to maximize initial quality, in contrast to rebuffers, which we wanted to minimize. Each column here represents one of the three knobs. And for each plot, the x-axis is the knob configuration value, whereas the y-axis is the modeled initial quality. So basically, each plot is showing how initial quality reacts when turning the knob. The shaded part of this graph is the confidence interval, meaning the uncertainty on the model. As you can see, the confidence interval is pretty large on the first step. We keep repeating this iterative process, A-B testing, analysis, finding new candidates, and changing config to improve the model. After each round of A-B test, the model keeps improving. As you can see on this last row, the confidence interval gets smaller and smaller, and our model is iteratively refined, and we have a better understanding of how the knobs are acting on this metric, especially near the optimal values. From our experience, a couple rounds of A-B test is enough to get a proper modeling. Simultaneously, the same modeling happens for the other metrics, and as a result, we can now visualize it as a multidimensional graph. So once the confidence interval is good enough, we can use the model to generate our Pareto frontier. This plot is a slice of the real Pareto frontier with a given initial quality. The real Pareto frontier is in reality a surface in a 3D space. Here, we are comparing the best possible tuning for play delay and rebuffers. All the points in this figure have the same initial quality as we slide the surface. Rebuffer metric is on the x-axis, whereas play delay is on the y-axis. Any config on the frontier line would be optimal. This means that these are the best operating points for this algorithm. Depending on your business use case, you might prefer a lower risk of rebuffer with a higher play delay, or a low play delay with a higher risk of rebuffers. Now, it's really up to you to decide, but you will be confident that these are the best operating points for your algorithm. Now, if you need to remember one thing from this talk, this is it. Bayesian optimization is an efficient exploration methodology that addresses our two challenges. First, to simultaneously optimize all QE metrics under constrained resources. And second, to find a single solution for a large and diverse set of sessions. This methodology fits really well with standard A-B testing techniques and gives you operating points pretty quickly. And really, don't be afraid by the underlying math complexity. A lot of open source implementations are available online to help you. The main challenge you will face is to plug this optimization step into your A-B framework. We are using it to tune ABR, but this technique can be applied to many other domains. Hence, your creativity is the limit. Up to you now to give it a try. And if you're interested in learning more or even joining our team, please contact us on Slack. Thanks a lot for your time, and I'm eager to answer your questions on Slack and online. Thank you.